In this video, I'd like to argue for a two-part thesis. The first part of this thesis is that contemporary liberalism, as it exists in the West today, is essentially nihilistic. That is to say, that contemporary liberalism is of such a character that to be a liberal means that you are not allowed to believe in anything strongly enough to actually take it seriously. The second part of the claim that I want to argue for is that this nihilistic aspect to contemporary liberalism makes it so that discussions about issues of public concern, that is, all sorts of public debate about any political issue, be it gay marriage, euthanasia, capital punishment, what have you. The nature of contemporary liberalism is such that because it does not allow one to, as I said, believe in anything strongly enough to actually take it seriously, the result is that discourse on these questions tends to be extremely vapid, extremely boring, where no one is allowed to ask any fundamental questions. Conversations on these topics, even if they are engaged in by high-level jurists, judges, or philosophers, from whom one would naturally expect a sophisticated level of argumentation, nevertheless tend to be, upon close examination, very bland, very boring, very vapid, insipid, uninteresting. The argumentation is frequently extremely bad. And as I said, the reason for this hollow and insipid character to modern public discourse has to do with the nature of liberalism and what it is that liberalism allows people to bring into public debate. Now, as part of my way of trying to make this point and argue for the claims that I've just laid out, I'd like to briefly discuss something quite interesting that happened to me a few days ago. This was a Facebook conversation, and it's a very short conversation. The actual reading of it won't go on for very long, but I'd like to go over this conversation and simply analyze it and make some comments about it first. That will be the beginning of my argument. Now, a little bit of background. The person with whom I was having this conversation, I'm going to refer to her as Vapid Liberal Woman, and it should be fairly clear relatively soon why I've chosen to refer to her this way. There's going to be another person involved in the conversation. I'm just going to call him ANCAP Musician, because this person is an ANCAP and also a musician. So the conversation is essentially just going to be a Facebook post made by Vapid Liberal Woman, my response to it, and then the conversation that ensued from that response. And I just like to comment on it. Now, hold on a second, let me get it up here in front of me. All right, here we go. So, the post from Vapid Liberal Woman goes as follows. We have a problem in the world right now, and that problem is extremism. We see it demonstrated in religion from factions of all major religions. People have twisted the words of their prophets and deities to match the ugliness of their thoughts. We see it demonstrated in politics, where people no longer engage in logic-based thinking but in black-and-white terms. We see extreme reactions to actions, where the reaction is often as despicable as the action. We see it demonstrated through racism from all races, where people completely gloss over the potential causes of the problems in our society and how long they'd persisted. America has humble origins, let us not forget. We don't want to try and fix the problems, but we want to push them down and refuse to address them, or we resort to hatred because that somehow requires less work, less accountability. The only way to fix this is to plug back into reality and quit thinking through the prism of fear. Fear-based thinking is easily exploited. It's when we are most vulnerable and most dangerous. I can do better, you can do better, we can do better. And then after that she has a series of hashtags. So it's hashtag religion, hashtag politics, hashtag love, racism, humanity, Islam, Christianity, Judaism, Hillary Clinton, Donald J. Trump. Okay, so first a couple of general comments about this post. It's fairly clear, or at least it should be, to the sort of audience that I've gathered, why I've chosen to call this person Vapid Liberal Woman. Her statement here is completely boring, uninteresting, standard sort of liberal boilerplate, really. It's the sort of standard plumb line that you would expect out of liberalism. So this kind of general bellyaching about people failing to get along and not thinking straight and not being rational. You can see this in her statement near the end, where she says the only way to fix this, all the problems that she outlines, is to plug back into reality and quit thinking through the prism of fear. So she's saying here that essentially those who do not espouse her friendly, sort of peaceable liberal views, let's say, must really therefore be motivated by fear. She also says that, as she puts it, people no longer engage in black and white thinking, but think in black and white terms. So there seems to be this fundamental belief underlying her sentiment that there is some kind of ultimate reason, some kind of ultimate logic, which can be appealed to resolve fundamental conflicts, fundamental disagreements that would emerge, for example, between two different religions like Christianity and Islam. They make incompatible claims with one another. These claims, you know, obviously cannot all be true. And so one must conclude that one of them is correct and the other not, or perhaps that both of them are wrong. But the belief here, the animating belief here, is that there is some kind of reason, some kind of logic, some kind of ultimate discursive apparatus to which we can refer that will allow us to resolve conflicts of this sort, and that the reason that these conflicts persist, or one of the reasons, is that people simply refuse to resort to this sort of thing. So, yeah, there's this basic liberal faith in a kind of ultimate fundamental reason. And if it's not clear why I'm referring to this as a liberal faith, it will be, because in a moment I plan to discuss John Rawls, who's sort of the philosophical grand poobah, if you will, of contemporary liberalism. And although I don't think that vapid liberal woman has read Rawls, I'd be extremely surprised if she had, it's nevertheless true that many of Rawls' ideas have gotten into the air, so to speak. And they're not even necessarily Rawls' ideas, because Rawls had been expressing these kind of general liberal sentiments. And because the West is permeated by liberalism, liberalism is in the air. It forms the intuitions of many of the people growing up in the West. And this person, vapid liberal woman, is highly educated, fairly intelligent, although I'm not particularly impressed by her. I would be lying if I said she was stupid. She isn't exactly stupid. She's just, well, completely unoriginal, at least from my perspective. And it should become clear why I think this. But basically, she's excoriating people for having beliefs motivated by what she takes to be fear. She is excoriating people by not appealing to the kind of fundamental reason that she believes exists, which can be appealed to resolve all sorts of fundamental conflicts that result from, let's say, religious disagreements or basic political disagreements either. Remember, she threw in Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump in her set of hashtags here. And so this is a kind of standard liberal sentiment here. It's pure liberalism, completely distilled to its essence, you might say. Now, looking through the comments on this post, all of them were extremely laudatory. All of her friends praised her for her wonderful insight. They said that, you know, she was so smart. They complimented her effusively. And then I came along. Now, I should probably say one general thing to sort of put this into a better context. I haven't been friends with this person on Facebook for very long. She, in fact, found me because she discovered that I liked some book that she had also liked and thought that maybe we could start a conversation on the basis of this, and this is sort of how I ran into her. But I had noticed that throughout her posts, particularly her political posts, she would say something, and it would be a completely insipid sort of standard liberal sentiment that requires no individuality, no originality, no sort of ability to think in interesting ways to come up with. It's just sort of very bland and standard. And she would post these things all the time. And after a while, I decided to be kind of like a gadfly and be the one guy to really seriously try to distinguish myself from all the people who were heaping praise upon her and actually try and offer some criticisms. Now, for the most part, I tried to be civil and I, tried to state my views stridently but respectfully. And that's sort of how it went along. I was sort of the person popping her little bubble, if you will, the gadfly, as I said. Okay, so let's move on to my comment on her post. This is a bit long, but not too long. I'll go through it here. Okay, so what I'm saying here. Okay, so here's my comment. What you seem to be saying here is, if you disagree with me, then you must be motivated by fear, and that's very bad. But how could you possibly know such a thing? Maybe someone could have a substantive disagreement with you because they are coming at an issue from a perspective completely different from your own. Maybe they are making fundamental assumptions that are totally different from your fundamental assumptions. But because you are unable to discern what those fundamental assumptions are, or because you can't see what it's like to make those assumptions, it just seems to you like fear is their motivation. I don't see how anyone could possibly rule something like that out definitively. It really seems to me like you're jumping the gun here. But more importantly, why do you think that being motivated by fear is always and necessarily a bad thing? What is the basis for this assumption? Someone could obey the law because they fear going to prison, but the fact that their lawful behavior is motivated by fear shouldn't bother too many of us. Can't at least some fears be legitimate? What's wrong with not smoking because you fear getting lung cancer? I can think of many other situations in which fear is a legitimate and acceptable motivator. One other thing. Logic-based thinking is not nearly as powerful as you seem to think that it is. All that logic can do is inform us about formal relationships between propositions and show us what follows from what. But when it comes to making decisions about very basic and fundamental things that inform our entire worldviews, logic is pretty powerless. Your apparent belief that fear is always a bad reason to do something or believe in something is a perfect example of the sort of fundamental, extra-rational belief that I have in mind here. Let me give you another example. Take a fundamentalist Wahhabi Muslim. Such a person believes that Allah is real and that he has revealed his wishes through Muhammad, the Quran, and the Hadith. He also believes that these texts must be read literally. If you believe these things, then it is completely rational to conclude, for example, that women should be killed if they cheat on their husbands. The latter belief clearly logically follows from the former ones, and the former beliefs are not subject to the test of rationality because they establish the fundamental bounds within which rationality can work in the first place. For someone who believes in Allah, Allah is the very ground of reason itself, the very thing that makes rationality possible and reason trustworthy. The revelations of Islam to a Muslim form the ground upon which reason rests. It therefore doesn't make any sense to accuse a Muslim fundamentalist of not thinking logically, because from his perspective, given his assumptions, he is thinking logically. For a Muslim fundamentalist, it is logical to advocate the implementation of Sharia. It only appears to you like he's being illogical because you are starting from different assumptions than his own. But logic does not deal in fundamental assumptions. It only deals with where we go after our fundamental assumptions have been made. All right. So, in this comment, basically, I make that sort of general criticism of why are you saying that those who disagree with you, who have views different from your own. How are you so sure that they are motivated by fear, first of all? And secondly, why is it always the case that fear is a bad motivator? Now, what I was trying to gently suggest to her by saying this is that I don't believe that she really believes that fear-based thinking, so-called, is always a bad thing. After all, and this person is very anti-Trump, so let's use that as an example. She is very afraid of the prospect of Trump becoming president. Now, if Trump were to be president, he would do things which, from her perspective, would be quite bad, and she's afraid of that. So her beliefs are motivated by fear of what Trump might do. Now, she wouldn't say that these beliefs therefore are bad or ill-founded or shouldn't be held or are irrational, She would say, rather, that her fears are justifiable, that they're legitimate, rational fears, and that it's acceptable to hold beliefs based on such fears, because those fears are legitimate. So the problem for her isn't really fear-based thinking versus non-fear-based thinking. It's thinking based on legitimate fears versus illegitimate fears. But then the question arises, which fears are legitimate and which ones are illegitimate, and how do we distinguish the one from the other? That's what I think was really in her mind, but she wanted to frame the discussion in terms of fear-based thinking versus non-fear-based thinking, because doing so would give her a dialectical advantage in the argument. She would be occupying a higher, less questionable position, if you will. But the real issue, the real thing, what's really in her mind, I believe, in saying what she said, is that certain people have illegitimate fears, and they're acting on these illegitimate fears. So the problem with their conclusions and what these people believe is not that they are motivated by fear per se, but that they are motivated by illegitimate fear. So that was the first thing. And the second thing, the part where I talk about the Wahhabi fundamentalist, is that I'm simply pointing out that there are certain worldviews that come from all sorts of sources, religion being the most conspicuous of them, and that these sources of worldviews provide one with fundamental assumptions and comprehensive doctrines that inform what one believes at the most basic level. They form Weltanschauungen for us. And once these Weltanschauungen, once these worldviews have been formed on that basis, whatever the basis may be, the basis could be that you're coming at life and all of your beliefs from the perspective of being a Christian or from the perspective of being a Wahhabi fundamentalist or what have you. But the point is that you're coming at something, no matter what it is, no matter what your set of beliefs are, with a set of fundamental assumptions, and that those assumptions then frame how you look at everything else. Now, these assumptions are not themselves subject to rational criticism. They are not things which can be questioned, because they are those things which form the bounds within which rationality can operate in the first place. If you don't take such things as given, you can't really do any thinking. There's no notion of rationality out there. In other words, when I said earlier that one of the ongoing assumptions in her statement was that there was a kind of ultimate rationality out there somewhere which could at least theoretically reconcile all conflicts between all fundamentally opposed positions, that there was something that reason itself, just as such, could reach, a kind of ultimate truth, and if people were only wise enough or honest enough to pursue this ultimate truth, that all of these conflicts of which she is, all these conflicts that she's bemoaning that are creating all these problems in the world, would vanish. Now, this is Enlightenment sensibility 101. She's expressing a sentiment that all of the Enlightenment philosophers, all of the major ones anyway, Rousseau would probably be an exception, and perhaps some of those who followed him, but the major ones, Diderot, Voltaire, and so on, she's expressing a sentiment that all of the Enlightenment philosophers believed. They believed that reason could arrive at true values for people, and that by using reason honestly and dispassionately, one could arrive at truth and dispel ignorance and superstition and inaugurate a kind of, you know, peace and kind of universal happiness and goodness and so on in the world. She's expressing these sentiments. Now, I'm not saying that she's necessarily read Voltaire or Diderot or any of these figures, but because the West is a liberal society, ideas of that sort are just in the air. We breathe them in just by existing. And so, without perhaps realizing it, she is expressing views of that sort. So, now, okay, so just to continue on with the conversation, the first person responding to my comment is ANCAP musician, and he says, "Great point about fear not always being a bad motivator. Sometimes not fearing things is the most illogical and destructive way to be." Of course, the real point of my comment, again, was not that fear is always, that there's a distinction between fear-based thinking and non-fear-based thinking. It's thinking based on legitimate fear and illegitimate fear. But, all right, moving on. The next comment is again from ANCAP musician, and he adds, it is also potentially illogical to assume fear is irrational. Well, yes, if you believe that certain fears are legitimate, then the rational thing to do would be to act on them, to do what must be done to avoid whatever it is that is dreaded through this legitimate fear. Okay, so I respond now to ANCAP musician, and I say, yes, that's what I meant when I said that the belief that fear is always a morally reprehensible source of motivation is an extra-rational fundamental assumption that you base your worldview on, and that is not subject to any kind of rational test. So that's another potential way to interpret a vapid liberal woman's post here. You could be more charitable, as I was initially, and say that what's really in her mind is the distinction between thinking and beliefs arrived on the basis of illegitimate fear versus legitimate fear. But another thing you could do is to just take her at her word and then say that she really does view all fear-based thinking as unequivocally universally bad. But if you accept that, then the question arises, how do we rationally justify that belief? And of course, as I suspect, you can't do it. It's one of these fundamental assumptions, fundamental beliefs that just inform her worldview and that are not subject to any kind of rational test. They are what we use, and they're what she starts with before she can even begin reasoning. Okay. Now, finally, a vapid liberal woman responds to me, and she seems quite annoyed. She says to me simply, I actually didn't say what you say I said. Now, at this point, I was incredulous, because I'm quite sure that I understood her correctly. ANCAP musician was able to get a response to her in before me, and he said, you said quit thinking through a prism of fear, because that's dangerous. Immediately afterward, I respond to a vapid liberal woman, and I write, so when you say, quote, I'm quoting her here, the only way to fix this is to plug back into reality and quit thinking through the prism of fear. Fear-based thinking is easily exploited. It is when we are most vulnerable and most dangerous, end quote. You're not actually condemning the fact that people sometimes come to certain beliefs because of fear? And in other words, I'm completely incredulous as to how she could possibly accuse me of misinterpreting her. Her words are rather obvious. It's rather clear that what she is saying, at least on the surface, is that there are certain people who reach beliefs because of fear, and because they are motivated by fear, the beliefs that they reach are bad, they're destructive, they do bad things, and they cause all sorts of problems in the world. And so she excoriates that. She condemns it. That's very clearly what she's saying. Okay, then ANCAP musician writes, sometimes it's dangerous to suppress fear and act like everything is fine when it's not. Okay, now, that's the end of the discussion, believe it or not, because what happened next is that vapid liberal woman deleted my comment, deleted all the responses to it, and then blocked me. So that's nice. She also, funnily enough, wound up blocking ANCAP musician. But, I suppose she just got annoyed at me for sort of refusing to constantly heap praises upon her for being critical. Now, I wasn't critical of her in a malicious way. I just wanted to, you know, prod her to think and perhaps develop some kind of interesting thoughts. You know, something other than the standard plumb-line liberalism that she seems to espouse. I wanted to shake her out of her vapidity, perhaps, but she wasn't having any of that, and she blocked me. Now, I don't really care that she blocked me. That's not important. What is important is that I think that this conversation that I had with her epitomizes something about public discourse in general within contemporary liberal societies. See, in my comment, I was criticizing her for making certain basic assumptions and then not bothering to justify them. That's really the gist of my criticism. And I also was saying that, in a sense, that's unavoidable. But she was pretending like she was above that because she's appealing to some sort of ultimate reason which supposedly transcends all such things. And I was trying to argue that there wasn't such a thing. This belief in this kind of ultimate reasonableness that transcends all of these sectarian differences between not just religions, but any other kind of comprehensive worldviews, metaphysical systems, beliefs of any sort that are fundamental and basic, that form the bedrock of anyone's Weltanschauung. it's a general belief of liberalism today that there is a kind of ultimate reason that transcends this. And that conversation epitomizes that, but I want to argue that this is a delusion. And that because liberalism has entertained this delusion for so long, it has produced vapid discourse in which people throw assumptions around, don't bother to justify them, and therefore produce discussions that are unedifying, quite like this discussion was. I had run straight to the bedrock of one of her assumptions, pointed out that she wasn't really trying to justify them and perhaps couldn't. She realized that she couldn't. This bothered her, probably generated some cognitive dissonance, I imagine, and then she proceeded to block me. And this epitomizes liberal discourse in liberal Western societies today. Now, from that, I want to segue into a discussion of a book. And the book is this. It is Disenchantment of Secular Discourse by Stephen D. Smith. Now, before I say anything about this book, I must give it a ringing, unequivocal endorsement. Everyone watching this should immediately go to the Amazon link that I left in the description and buy this book. Especially if you happen to be a neo-reactionary. Everyone should read it, whatever your views are. But if you're a neo-reactionary, you really should, because you'll love the book. I can promise you that. And it'll probably speak to something that you believe. And if you happen to be a neo-reactionary who's also an atheist, well, then you really need to read the book. Theistic neo-reactionaries will also find very much of value here. But I think atheistic neo-reactionaries will be affected most of all. Now, why is this? Well, let me explain Smith's basic thesis in his book. What he says is essentially what I've been saying, that public discourse, as seen in things like Supreme Court opinions or discussions among philosophers concerning various important political issues, so being like gay marriage, abortion, euthanasia, separation of church and state, what have you, anything of public concern. Discussions today about these topics tend to be very boring, very insipid, very unedifying. The arguments surrounding them tend to be quite bad, quite hollow. It always seems as if people are making fundamental assumptions that they're not bothering to justify. And one almost gets the sense that people are more screaming their intuitions at one another than actually trying to create any kind of fundamental basic arguments for anything. And the reason that this is the case is that the constraints of secular liberalism prevent them from introducing explicitly the fundamental assumptions that they would need to introduce in order to truly and ultimately justify the views that they wish to defend. Now, because the constraints of secular liberalism prevent them from doing this, the only way for them to really conjure up the justifications that they need for their positions is to do what Smith calls smuggling. And smuggling is Smith's term for essentially trying to bring in assumptions or claims or axioms, if you will, that if stated explicitly would be unacceptable within the framework allowed by modern secular liberal rationalism. And so in order to make them acceptable, in order to make these things palatable within this framework, they must be dressed up in some other way. And so philosophers and jurists and anyone else engaged in public discourse therefore has to engage in a kind of deceptive and self-deceptive game just so that they can make arguments for what they believe. And for those of us who happen to be insightful enough to see this, we immediately see that public discourse is boring, it's shallow, it's a complete sham, and nothing interesting happens in it. Now, Smith goes through a number of examples in his book to try and illustrate this. And I won't go through them all, but a partial survey of some of the things that he discusses will be very valuable, because up to now I've been sort of making my argument and explaining the thesis of Smith's book as well as my own thesis in these very general terms. So perhaps if we dive into something more concrete, it can be made more clear what it is exactly that I'm trying to argue. All right. Now, Smith devotes a chapter in his book to euthanasia, to physician-assisted suicide, to so-called right to die issues. And he mentions two prominent Supreme Court cases, both having happened, I believe, in 1997. And the first of them is Washington versus Glucksberg, and the second is Vacco versus Quill. And he refers to these two collectively as Vacco, as Glucksberg, as Glucksberg Quill, because the decisions in these cases were essentially similar and had similar legal consequences, and so they could be referred to collectively. Now, what happened in these cases is the following. The first of these cases, the Glucksberg case, was a case, obviously, in Washington State. And it involved the issue of physician-assisted suicide. So, for example, let's say that there is some sort of a terminally ill patient. This person is suffering tremendously. Prolonging his life, although possible with the proper medical treatment, will just expose him to all sorts of suffering. And after quite a bit of reflection and serious thinking on the matter, the patient concludes that he would like to have life-sustaining treatment shut off and to simply be allowed to waste away and die. So, for example, or if the patient himself is not capable of making this determination, the legal agents or the family of the patient will do it. So, for example, this could be a person in a vegetative state with no hope of ever recovering full consciousness, being placed on a feeding tube, and the family then deciding, well, perhaps it's best to remove the feeding tube, let the person die, and end their suffering. That sort of thing. Now, that's one aspect of physician-assisted suicide. There's another aspect, however, and it is the second aspect that these two cases concern. The second aspect is as follows. It is one thing for a physician to simply cease to administer life-sustaining treatment. But what if you had a terminally ill patient, or a patient of any sort, really, who was suffering seriously and had decided that life was simply no longer worth living for him, and requested that not only that the physician cease to administer life-sustaining treatment to him, but that the physician procure, let's say, a lethal dose of morphine for him to kill him quickly and easily and painlessly. Let us say furthermore that the patient was not capable of committing suicide himself. He was incapacitated in some way, and that that he required the assistance of the physician to do this for him. It's physician-administered, physician-assisted suicide. Is that admissible? Now, Glucksberg, Quill, both of those cases, concerned that issue. And the state courts, the Quill case was a New York case, the Glucksberg case a Washington case. The appellate courts in both of those states ruled that indeed physician-assisted suicide was acceptable. And the judges in those cases justified their reasoning by appeals to individual autonomy and things of that nature. Now, the Supreme Court got wind of these state-level court cases and decided to deliberate on them and produce rulings at the federal level, and that's where we got the Glucksberg and Quill cases. And the Supreme Court overruled the decisions of these two appellate courts and said that while it is acceptable for a physician to cease to administer life-sustaining treatment to a patient at the request either of the patient himself or of his legal agents or family, it is not acceptable for the physician to procure something for the patient which would end his life, such as, say, a lethal dose of morphine. So the physician is allowed to cease administering treatment, but he's not allowed to positively administer anything which would result in the death of the patient. And now this brings up several problems. How did the Supreme Court justify this decision? Well, because it seems at first glance that whether a physician ceases to administer life-sustaining treatment or whether he positively administers some treatment that leads to the death of the patient, in the end, the consequence is the same. the patient dies. So what basis is there to make a distinction between the two and to say that the former is admissible and the latter not? Well, the Supreme Court attempted to produce arguments to this effect, and as Smith points out, they were not very impressive. They were, they left something to be desired, let's put it that way. One argument that was made by the court attempted to appeal to causation. So, for example, when a physician ceases to administer life-sustaining treatment, cuts off a feeding tube, for example, it is not the physician or any actions of the physician that causes the death of the patient. Rather, what causes the death of the patient is certain natural processes, starvation, brain death, you name it. On the other hand, in the case of a physician administering, say, a lethal dose of morphine or some other drug that results in the death of the patient, there is an action that the physician performs which actively, positively results in the patient's death. Therefore, in the latter case, the physician is causally responsible. He plays a causal role in the patient's death, and in the former case, he does not. That was one argument they gave. Now, the problem with this is that it's not clear, it's not possible to really clearly formalize this distinction. And Smith brings up a case of certain philosophical heavyweights of contemporary philosophy, coming together to write what was called a philosopher's brief on the issue of euthanasia and physician-assisted suicide. And these were philosophers like John Rawls, Thomas Nagel, Robert Nozick, Martha Nussbaum, and a few others. They collectively wrote arguments about this issue. And in one section, they pointed out, for example, let's say you have a situation in which there is a deep-sea diver who is using some kind of breathing tube by which, you know, to breathe, to gather oxygen, and you, who are above sea level, clogs the tube with something and prevents the diver from being able to breathe. Now, it is true that you do not directly kill the diver. It is suffocation that kills the diver. It's a kind of physiological process that results in the diver's death. But surely you are responsible for the diver's death. And it makes sense to say in that case that you caused the diver's death. See, the problem here with this causation distinction that the court made is that in every case of a death, there is some physiological process that happens. When someone dies, their heart stops always, no matter how they are killed. The heart stops functioning. Various physiological things always happen. And it's really not clear what is meant by saying that in one case, the physician doesn't cause death, and in the other, he does. I mean, in the case of a physician removing a feeding tube, the physician surely understands that the patient will die without this treatment, and by removing it, he understands that his action of removing the tube will bring about the patient's death. So why is it the case that he's not causing the death of the patient? That doesn't seem to make any sense. Take the following example. Suppose that there's some patient in a hospital on a feeding tube, and I really hate him. I just hate this bastard. I hate his guts, don't like anything about him, and I contrive to sneak into his hospital bed and remove his feeding tube because it will kill him. Now, does it make any sense to say that I was not responsible for killing him? I mean, clearly not. Clearly I am responsible. Clearly I played a causal role. Clearly I killed this person in that situation. So this distinction is really difficult to sustain, and the reasoning underlying it, I hope you can see, is quite bad. The other argument, the other major argument that was made by the Supreme Court had to do with intent. And this brought up the doctrine of double effect. And very briefly, what the doctrine of double effect is that it says that actions which lead to... actions done with the intent to produce an evil effect are immoral, but actions which are done with the intent to produce a good effect, but which may happen by happenstance produce evil effects as side effects, are not necessarily immoral. So what matters is the intent. So to apply this to the case of euthanasia, when a physician removes a patient's feeding tube, or something of that nature, what he's doing is that he's intending to extinguish the patient's suffering. He's intending to prevent them from suffering. He's not intending to kill them. It just so happens that in doing what he must do to end their suffering, the person also happens to have to die. The death of the patient is a side effect here, but the intent of the patient is to eliminate suffering. On the other hand, in the case where the physician actively administers a drug, the intent is to kill the patient. The physician knows that by administering a lethal dose of this drug, the patient will die. And so he's acting with the intent to kill the patient. Now, the problem with this argument is, once again, the distinction here is difficult to sustain. If Jack Kevorkian were to administer a lethal dose of morphine to a suffering patient, he could say that he administered the drug to the patient because he wanted to eliminate the patient's suffering, and he could sincerely have wanted to do that, and yet also realize that the only way to eliminate that particular patient's suffering, given the state that he was in, was to kill him. And so in practical circumstances, there's no way to separate intending to kill the patient and intending to end the patient's suffering. In cases of terminal illness, these may often be one and the same. So this is another example of just really bad sort of reasoning used by the court. Now, what are we to say about this? Are we to say that Supreme Court judges are sophists? Or should we try to probe a bit more deeply to see where it is that their intuitions are coming from? Because these judges all seem to implicitly also be drawing upon a distinction between killing someone and merely letting them die. That is, it's said that when a physician merely removes a feeding tube or ceases to administer life-sustaining treatment, he is allowing the patient to die, whereas when he administers a lethal dose of a drug, he is killing the patient, and that there's an important moral difference between the two. That's what the court is trying to argue. But how can one sustain this intuition? How can one sustain this belief? I've already shown that it can't be sustained using the rationales that the court gave, the appeals to intent and causation. So what else is there? Well, you often hear in the writings of not only the Supreme Court judges, but even the lower court judges when they rule on these two cases, appeals to the natural course of nature. So for example, when a person is sick and suffering a great deal, if a physician were to administer a lethal dose of a drug and kill that person, he would, in a sense, be preventing that person's life from ending naturally. He would be making an imposition upon nature and ending the person's life unnaturally. Whereas, if life-sustaining treatment were simply removed, the person would just die of natural causes. And in that instance, nature would take its course. Now, that's interesting, but why should we assume that there is anything of normative or ethical significance to be derived from, so to speak, letting nature take its course? Well, see, we can't, because there's a problem here. There's what philosophers know as the is-ought gap. And at this point, Smith makes a very interesting point. He says that in pre-modern thought, in pre-modern philosophy, ancient Greek philosophy or medieval philosophy, for example, nature was thought of in a way completely different to the way in which nature is seen in modern thought. In modern thought, nature is inanimate. There are simply particles that are being acted upon by all sorts of physical forces. There are physical objects that physical forces affect, and these physical objects, being affected by these physical forces, simply do things. And things just simply happen as a result of these physical forces acting on physical objects. There's no inherent purpose, there's no inherent teleology, nothing of that sort. Out of the original four Aristotelian causes, and anyone who's watched my videos on the theological origins of modernity will by now know this, but out of the four original Aristotelian causes, so material, efficient, formal, and final. Formal and final causality were eliminated by modern thought, and only material and efficient causality were considered acceptable. Now, for the purposes of this discussion, I only want to talk about final causality. Final causality is, of course, purpose. It's teleology. In Aristotle's philosophy of nature, he believed natural motions, natural events, to be tinged with purpose. Nature was a cosmos, as he called it. It was a grand metaphysical scheme which aimed at some sort of purpose. That within things in nature, one could detect potentialities, and that these potentialities would incline these objects to do certain things and realize their natures, realize their inherent telos, their inherent purposes. So, for example, within an acorn, because of an acorn being what it is, you can find within it the potentiality for growing into a tree. And so the telos of an acorn is to be, you know, planted into the ground, watered, and eventually become a tree, and so on. And you could apply this to anything in nature. And Aristotle believed that because these things are inherently teleological and purposive, that this gives what is in nature a normative dimension. And so there is an intrinsic normativity to the course of nature. Now, that's all well and good, but the problem is that, as I said, modern philosophy rejected this. And contemporary liberalism very much comes out of this modern philosophical milieu. And given that these sorts of things have been rejected, it is inadmissible for these Supreme Court judges to make explicit appeals to Aristotelian metaphysics and to teleology. Contemporary liberalism and the strictures that it imposes does not allow them to do this. And so because they can't do it explicitly, they have to make appeals to things like distinctions between killing and letting die, which again only makes sense given a kind of telos. So for example, if someone is simply allowed to die, that's because there are certain potentialities that are in them naturally which would incline them to death. And so given their state, they would naturally be driven by whatever potentialities exist in them to die. They would naturally die of natural causes. And so it is ethically acceptable to allow this to happen. Whereas if you actively do something to kill a person, that death is unnatural. You have gone against the inherent telos and order of nature, and therefore that is ethically bad. That's something that would be said by a pre-modern philosopher like Thomas Aquinas or Aristotle. The problem is that these Supreme Court judges here are modern secular liberals, and they can't do that. They can't make appeals to that sort of thing. And so when they appeal to distinctions between killing someone and letting them die, or to the course of nature, and thereby suggesting that there's some kind of inherent normativity to this, they're fumbling around and they're speaking a bunch of nonsense. They have certain moral intuitions which they want to maintain, which they don't want to abandon, but which they cannot justify given their broader beliefs about the nature of the world and the nature of reality and metaphysics that they've inherited simply by dint of the fact that they are modern secular liberals. And so the result is that these judges have to make legal opinions where they're not allowed to give the full-fledged metaphysical justification for what they want to argue for, because liberalism itself makes appeals to these kinds of things inadmissible. Now, Smith is not saying that these judges are consciously doing this. In fact, he's willing to give them the benefit of the doubt and to say that often they're doing it unconsciously. But the point is, and a very interesting point is, that these judges, and not only these judges, but really everyone living today, to one degree or another in the contemporary liberal West, retain certain moral intuitions or moral beliefs. But because of changes inaugurated into intellectual life itself by modernity, they are no longer able to appeal to the fundamental metaphysical principles that they would need to appeal to in order to justify what they believe. So, very briefly, Smith describes how, as I said, in pre-modern thought, nature was tinged with purpose. In modern thought, it's not anymore. And another, the sort of central issue, and the reason why all of this is a problem for contemporary liberalism, is that contemporary liberalism is essentially Rawlsian. Now, for anyone who doesn't know very much about John Rawls, I'll describe some of his beliefs briefly. And when I describe them, however, I should not be taken to say that it is only with John Rawls that beliefs of this sort have come to acquire currency in the liberal West. It's just that he expressed them very explicitly, and he had risen to prominence because of that. But beliefs like his have been present in Western thought in one form or another for all of the history of modernity. So Rawls, in his theory of justice, aimed to set out rational political principles of political and social organization, that all people living in a society could agree to. Now, when he says all people living in a society, he's implicitly making the assumption that the society in question here is a pluralistic one, that it is a society in which people have all sorts of different religious backgrounds, that they have different fundamental beliefs about metaphysics and philosophy and so on, and that these beliefs will often conflict. And if something is not done to resolve these conflicts, there will be violence, and it will not be possible to live peaceably with people who differ in their fundamental worldviews, their fundamental comprehensive doctrines, as he calls them. And so he attempts to set out what he thinks are fundamental principles that everyone, regardless of their comprehensive doctrine, would ascribe to. Now, I'm not going to go too deeply into what Rawls believes, because I don't want this to be a video just on Rawls. But he starts out from that sort of general base. He also goes on to describe what he calls public reason. And this is very similar to what I just described. So he says, okay, look, in a pluralistic society in which people disagree about fundamental beliefs, in which they have differing fundamental doctrines, a Muslim has certain fundamental beliefs that are incompatible with Catholicism, which are incompatible with Judaism, which may be incompatible with a kind of utilitarian, libertarian of some sort, which may be incompatible with some of the fundamental beliefs of a traditional conservative, which may be incompatible with the beliefs of a more sort of basic secular liberal, and so on. Because these people all have fundamental principles that differ from one another's, and they have to get along, we have to, so to speak, leave these fundamental principles, these comprehensive doctrines, at home. We have to check them out at the door when we go in to discuss issues of public concern. When we discuss matters in the public square, we must not make reference to our comprehensive doctrines. And so, otherwise we won't be able to get along. Otherwise we'll just fight with each other. That's what Rawls says. Because differences between comprehensive doctrines are not reconcilable by reason, and so we have to make use of something else. And Rawls terms this public reason. So, for example, if you are a Muslim, and you believe, for example, that a woman should be submissive to her husband, then if you are to make arguments to this effect in the public square, you may not make reference to the Quran, you cannot make reference to any kind of Islamic doctrines that might enforce your beliefs. If you are to make arguments for this claim, they have to be arguments which are independent of any kind of metaphysics and independent of any kind of appeal to any kind of religion. The same goes if you are a Catholic and you believe, for example, that abortion is immoral. You cannot say, when you are in public debate, that abortion is immoral because God says so, because God commands one not to do this. That's simply inadmissible within the public sphere of a pluralistic liberal society, as Rawls says. And so we have to resort to, again, this thing called public reason. Now, what is public reason? Well, I won't go into the details of it, but basically what it turns out to be is something that is entirely amenable and acceptable to the current contemporary liberal zeitgeist. It just conveniently happens to be liberalism, and Rawls makes a sort of argument for it that seems to suggest that it's kind of this ultimate thing that transcends all given metaphysical or religious doctrines which he thinks are particularistic. So this public reason, this ultimate thing which just so happens to produce conclusions favorable to liberalism, is ultimate, it transcends all of these things, it surrounds you know, all religions like Islam or Catholicism or any other comprehensive metaphysical belief system from which one can derive ethical beliefs. And and Rawls basically just ends it that way. Now, again, I could go into more detail, but the basic thing that you have to understand is that Rawls believes that there's a kind of ultimate reason which can be used to transcend all of these particularistic creeds and therefore overcome the differences between them and allow people who live in a pluralistic society to get along with one another. Now people have criticized Rawls for a number of things. So for example, in one of his thought experiments, and this also happens to be a kind of consequence of public reason, one of these thought experiments is known as the original position. So when we are deliberating in public about what principles of justice to base our society on, Rawls says, we should imagine that we don't know anything about what position we will occupy in society. You don't know what sex you will be. You don't know what race you will be. You don't know what religious group you will belong to. You don't know how wealthy or how poor you will be. You don't know what you will believe, what your fundamental basic philosophical commitments will be. You don't know anything like this. Anything which could result in, again, a comprehensive doctrine, like a certain religious belief or a certain totalistic metaphysical picture of things, is to be rejected. And we are to simply assume that we don't know anything about these things, and given that we don't know anything about what we would be like with respect to all of these things, position in society, fundamental beliefs, religion, race, sex, etc. Given that we don't know anything about that, and what we would be like with respect to those things, what principles should we agree on? He derives a few other principles. Now, people have criticized this approach by saying, well, if you take away a man's race, if you take away a man's religion, if you take away the fact that he's a man, he doesn't know his sex, if you take away his economic position in society, if you take away any kind of fundamental belief that could possibly shape him into what he is, what is left, exactly? I mean, if you take away all these basic bedrock things from someone, you don't really have a person left. You have this kind of free-floating, ethereal wraith. Why should we do this? These aren't really people anymore that we're talking about. It becomes this kind of bizarre situation. So Rawls has been criticized on those grounds. And also just because there's a strong suspicion that the conclusions that he ultimately comes to are kind of self-serving. So for example, take the belief that we all must abandon our fundamental convictions at the door when we discuss things in the public square. Why should we do that? I mean, isn't that itself a kind of fundamental belief, a kind of part of a comprehensive doctrine? And if it is, doesn't that make Rawls' whole thought experiment here involving the original position and public reason to be self-referentially incoherent? I would think so. Now Rawls would say, well, we need to do this to prevent us from fighting with one another. But suppose that you were a Muslim fundamentalist once again, and you said, well, who cares if stridently insisting on my particular interpretation of Islam would result in warfare and conflict? Who cares? What I believe is the truth. And if I must fight and kill for the truth, so be it. Now, what do you say to a person like that? Well, you can't say anything. There's no appeal that a liberal like Rawls could make to such a person. In other words, there's an implicit assumption here that reason is not powerful enough to arrive at ultimate truth, and so we should put aside all hopes to reach that and simply content ourselves with trying to get along. But suppose that you're more interested in the truth as you see it prevailing than you are in getting along. There's nothing that someone like Rawls can say to you. And so a person like that just simply has to be written out of the conversation. You cannot be allowed into the public square. Now, there's a very interesting article that was published in 1996 by Stanley Fish at the magazine First Things. It's called Why Can't We All Just Get Along? I'm going to give a link to that article. And he talks about things very similar to this. And he ultimately says that because fundamental religious convictions tend to be such that they value what they take to be the truth as revealed in those religions more than they do peace, that religion therefore has to be written out of public conversation. It has to be written out of public life and relegated to simply being a private matter. And that once you relegate religion to being a private matter in this way, that explains why it is that in the liberal West there has been a gradual process of secularization, and why religion over time has had less and less and less influence on the public square. But of course, this is really bizarre, because what religions all purport to do is that they provide comprehensive Weltanschauungen for people, comprehensive worldviews about everything, and that necessarily includes a political dimension. And so if a religion is not allowed to influence politics, it is in a certain sense not a full-fledged religion. Even in the West, with our notions of separation of church and state, these notions can very well be argued to derive from Christianity. I believe it's John chapter 18, verse 36, where Christ says, "My kingdom is not of this world." You can make an argument that that biblical verse is the basis for the West, for the separation of church and state in the West. This is why I'm annoyed by a lot of the critics of Islamic fundamentalism, for example, who say that Islam is not really a religion, it's a political system. This is nonsense. There's no distinction between a religion and a political system. Every religion is a political system. It's just that because of the particular circumstances of our cultural evolution here in the West, where we happen to fall under the sway of a certain religion, Christianity, that tended to want to separate itself from politics and to declare itself a thing separate from the secular political realm, that we even have this notion of separation of church and state, and that we even have this spurious distinction emerge between a religion on the one hand, which is supposed to be something entirely private and something that ideally does not influence public discussion, and then politics, which does. But in other religions, in most other religions, this has never been the case. Religion has always had something to say about politics. Even Christianity, which says that religion and politics are separate, nevertheless, by saying that, has something to say about politics. So a religion which doesn't influence politics isn't a real full-fledged religion. That's one of the points that Fish makes in his article. It's very interesting, quite a long article, but I'd encourage everyone to read it. So, now, having established this this fact about the nature of contemporary liberalism, that we must all leave our comprehensive doctrines at the door lest we come to blows with one another, we see now what I was trying to argue for in the beginning, that liberalism is essentially, fundamentally, irreducibly, unavoidably nihilistic, in the sense that to be a liberal means that you are not allowed to believe in anything strongly enough to actually take it seriously. If you are a Catholic, for example, and you take Catholicism seriously, and you believe in it, then you believe that Catholicism has something to say about what politics should be like. You believe that abortion should be categorically prohibited, that people should be categorically not allowed to divorce one another, that when a man and a woman are married, and it can only be a man and a woman if you're a Catholic, when a man and a woman are married, then their bond of marriage is forever. It is indissoluble. It may not be broken, legitimately. And so the state may not promote divorce, may not grant divorces or anything of that sort. So there is a political dimension to Catholicism. Now, liberalism asks you to throw that away. But if you really do throw that away, if you're serious about throwing that away, how seriously do you take your Catholicism? How much of a Catholic are you really? The problem is that if you do take Catholicism seriously enough to insist that this not be thrown away, that this not be checked out at the door, then you will simply not be allowed at the table of public discussion that liberalism holds, because that's just the nature of liberalism, hence the secularizing tendency. And so what people like Fish and also by implication Smith here in his book are saying is that secular liberalism creates a kind of cage for us. It constrains our discourse, it constrains what we're allowed to say, and because all fundamental ethical justifications in the past and all pre-modern thought came out of a different conception of nature which had certain metaphysical and ultimately theological implications, because if you accept the classical picture of nature as teleological, as tinged with purpose, then I would argue you must believe in God if you believe in that. But of course, to a secular liberal, that's inadmissible because it requires a religious commitment, and all arguments about what we are to do in the public square, all public discourse, according to the constrictions of liberalism, the strictures of liberalism, have to be theologically neutral. But if making our arguments theologically neutral means that we can't ultimately justify them, then our discourse is going to be vapid. It's going to be crap. It's going to be boring. It's going to be insipid. It's going to be nonsensical, stupid, very easily refuted. And it's going to be clear that people with any kind of philosophical insight, with any ability to see to the core of philosophical problems, will find discourse like that to be hopelessly and completely and utterly unsatisfying. And that produces the sad, nihilistic, degraded, terrible situation that we live in today. There's another point that Smith brings up. He talks about a book written by philosopher Carl Becker at Yale University in the 1930s. And it's a great book. I recommend everyone read it. The book is called The Heavenly City of the 18th Century Philosophers. And he talks about this transition from the pre-modern conception of nature to the more modern one that began to be seriously favored by Enlightenment thinkers. Now, Enlightenment thinkers like Voltaire, Diderot, and so on, they all had political programs. They believed that the world was hopelessly corrupt, that there were all sorts of terrible injustices going on, and that something had to be done to remedy these things. But in order to really compare one society to another and to say that one was more socially just or morally preferable to another, one had to have some sort of standard by which to evaluate morality. The trouble is that these old Enlightenment philosophers tended to be very anti-clerical and anti-religious, and therefore they rejected all of the traditional religious arguments and also the traditional natural law argument that made reference to teleology. So they had to come up with a different way for creating a fundamental basis for ethics. And what they ultimately chose to do was to make the same sorts of appeals that pre-modern philosophers like Aquinas made to natural law, to the law of nature, and so on. But instead of talking about what Aquinas was talking about as, you know, being something reflective of the inherent teleology that's present in nature in the special metaphysical picture that a pre-modern philosopher like Aquinas would have had of nature, they said something different. Because they rejected teleology in nature and had the modern mechanistic conception of the natural world, they had to derive what they called natural law from a different source. And this source was empirical investigation. What they would do is they would look at all sorts of different societies, compare their customs, compare what they found moral and immoral, and try to find universal constants that pervaded all of these societies. And when they found these sort of universal attributes, they would attempt to build moral systems on the basis of that. Now, the problem with this is that it really doesn't make sense to speak of any kind of behavior as being universally moral in a kind of empirical sense, and that it goes throughout all societies. Because in all societies, you do see acts of charity, kindness, goodness, heroism, and so on. You see all of these praiseworthy things in every society to some degree. But you also see cruelty, violence, oppression, fraud, lying, and all sorts of terrible things. You see them also in every society. So if the argument is that the basis for our morality should be that which is universal in human society, well, things that we would intuitively regard as good are universal and they exist in every human society, but also things which are bad. So how will we distinguish the good from the bad if all we have to go on is just whatever happens to be universally present as empirically observed? We don't have a basis for making such a distinction. So what we have to do is not observe what is universally present in all human societies in an empirical sense, but actually make a distinction between good and bad, and then go from there. And empiricism is not going to help us in that regard. And once again, we have the is-ought problem, which David Hume, another Enlightenment philosopher, famously pointed out. From some matter of fact alone, it cannot follow that some given moral conclusion is either right or wrong. Now, as I've argued in a previous video at one point, I believe this was in my video on Descartes in my Theological Origins series, I said that the is-ought problem is not really a philosophical problem. It's just a consequence of a certain modern philosophical assumption, that assumption being that nature is not tinged with a teleological dimension. If you take teleology out of your metaphysical picture of nature, then of course you're going to get the is-ought distinction, the fact-value gap. But yeah, so these Enlightenment philosophers had to deal with that. They had no way of really solving the problem. So what they essentially did is that they conducted their historical surveys, their kind of anthropological surveys of different human societies in their attempt to derive what they called universal values, but they did it in a very selective way. So they just took all the things that they liked and called them universal and built their morality on that. And Becker points this out in great detail in his book. And he has quite a lot of fun doing it. He's very kind of witty and sarcastic as he goes through this description, because he's kind of noticed that they're engaged in a kind of self-deceptive parlor game. And they're sort of fooling themselves into thinking that they're actually doing something interesting when they're not. Now, what's interesting here is that a lot of contemporary liberal philosophers do something similar. And Smith discusses in particular Martha Nussbaum and her famous capabilities approach to ethics, to morality. So Nussbaum is a philosopher, and she attempts to give an ultimate philosophical justification for a certain view in ethics. She's aware that meta-ethics has proposed many thorny and difficult problems of justification for all sorts of ethical approaches, and she has her own suggestion for how to deal with these things, and believes that she's found a way to deal with these kind of thorny issues of justification. So, what is her capabilities approach, and has she succeeded in what she claims to have done? Now, in examining this as I'm about to do, this is going to be yet another example of a really bad, insipid argument where, once again, because of the strictures of liberal rationalism, we're not allowed to ask any fundamental questions. So, let me just state Nussbaum's position first. Okay, so as the name of it suggests, she believes that there are certain fundamental human capabilities, and that it is a moral duty to create a society in which these capabilities can be developed to their fullest in each person. And a society which does this is one which truly allows human beings to flourish, and therefore, for that reason, is a truly moral society. Okay, now, she lists 10 capabilities. Let's see if I can remember them all. Okay, it's life, bodily health, bodily integrity, ability to use one's senses, imagination, and thought. There's emotion and the ability to exercise that. There's practical reason, which is just thinking about issues in ethics and also just issues about how one will do something or achieve some goal given that one has a certain end. What means will I resort to achieve my end? And also moral theorizing comes into that. That's practical reason. Let's see, number 7 is what she calls affiliation. And what this means is really it's just the human desire for social contact and social association, to live in society and association with other human beings. Interestingly, she says that a corollary of this principle of affiliation is a kind of non-discrimination principle, because what affiliation supposedly requires is that one live in society in ways that are non-demeaning, non-insulting, and that are respectful of the dignity of the person. And that, according to her, entails non-discrimination. Number 8, interaction with other species. So things like animal rights will come into the picture after that point. And number 9 is play. And number 10 is control over one's environment. So These 10 things she lists, and she says that they're human capabilities, and that
a society which allows these things to exist and allows people to develop these capabilities to their fullest is the sort of society which we should strive to achieve. Okay, how does she justify this? Well, I hate to say this because she is a distinguished philosopher, and I'm just some guy on YouTube, so I'm gonna invariably and unavoidably sound really arrogant by saying this, but how she does this is not very well, frankly. She's, well, for much of her argument, she seems to appeal flatly to intuition. She says, look, it just seems intuitively plausible that what humans need for flourishing, to live truly fulfilling, happy lives, are these 10 things that I've listed. Now, the problem with this appeal to intuition, is what happens if someone doesn't share your intuitions? What do you say to them? And, you know, people have different ethical intuitions and presumably have reasons for holding the intuitions that they have. They have more basic, more fundamental beliefs which might ground those intuitions, and shouldn't we explore those? So, for example, she, as I mentioned, she believes in all sorts of anti-discrimination or non-discrimination laws because the principle of affiliation, the capability of affiliation that she's in favor of, supposedly entails that. And she thinks that non-discrimination should be a legal matter in every just society, that no one may discriminate on what she calls arbitrary bases, you know, race, sex, what have you. I don't have these moral intuitions. I believe that someone who legitimately owns property, and there's a technical definition to legitimate that I won't go into, but a legitimate owner of property may either allow another person to use the owner's property or to not use it for whatever reason the owner sees fit. And that means that the owner has the right to discriminate on the basis of these things that Nussbaum considers arbitrary. So I don't share her intuitions in that regard. What's she going to say to me? Another example is that as a result of a combination of the affiliation capability and the capability of about bodily health, she believes that everyone must have the ability to regularly have sex with other people. Now, this poses many thorny problems for practical implementation. For example, what if you're just really ugly and unattractive and no one voluntarily wants to have sex with you? What happens? Does the government force people to have sex with you? I mean, for God's sake. You know, she seems to think that that's a matter of public concern. That seems to be an intuition of hers, apparently, considering the fact that she often makes appeals to intuition in justifying her ethical system here. I don't have these intuitions. I think those intuitions are crazy. I have completely diametrically different intuitions to those. I don't think that the government should have anything whatsoever to do with things like that. In no way should it possibly work to guarantee that every citizen living under its dominion is sexually gratified. That's absurd. So what will she say to me? It doesn't seem like there's much she can say to me if intuition is the only basis for which she can argue for her approach. Now, there is another more general point to be made about appeals to intuition with regard to ethics. Why are these intuitions to be given any weight? In other words, if someone has a moral intuition that murder is wrong, for example, but treating your child with love and kindness is morally right, what does that mean? I mean, yes, it's a feeling that a certain thing is good and a certain other thing is bad, but so what? I mean, in what way does this feeling differ from the feeling that, say, eating chocolate ice cream is good and eating raw sewage is bad? Why can't we say that those moral intuitions and those feelings about eating either chocolate ice cream or sewage, why can't we say that those two things are on the same level? Sure, it seems like they're not, but you're just appealing to another intuition here. In other words, you haven't really dealt with the problem of why these intuitions are meaningful and why they're to have weight. Now, one way in which we could say that moral intuitions have weight and that they're worth paying attention to is if we believe that our moral intuitions are like guideposts which reflect a certain underlying normative metaphysical order. But that requires a broader and deeper metaphysics. And of course, if you believe something like that, then all of a sudden intuitions have weight. But if you don't, then they're just random things and you can afford to forget about them. You can very well ask, why should we care? The trouble is, Nussbaum doesn't want to go that route. She doesn't want to go into any kind of deeper, more fundamental metaphysical principles, especially not things like Aristotelian natural law theory, which I've been heavily suggesting throughout this video. And this is funny because she's actually a classicist. She's an admirer of Plato and Aristotle, and she's no doubt aware of the things that I've been talking about here. So, you know, one would think that she knows better than to simply say, well, I'm appealing to intuition here. But that's really all she does. Another thing she tries to do is she tries to appeal to what she calls a truly human life, or a really human life. Now, if you look at her list of capabilities, most, if not all, of the societies that have ever existed in human history have failed to measure up to what her standard of a just society is. So does that mean that the overwhelming majority of people who have ever lived in human history have not lived really human lives? That seems a bit ridiculous, don't you think? I mean, yeah, you can make it definitionally true. That is, you could stipulate that to be the case. But is that really discursively or dialectically helpful? That just seems like it would make mischief of things. And furthermore, what does it mean to say that some life is really human? Now, you could mean that in a positive sense, where you say, well, you're living a really human life if you live a life in a society that allows you to cultivate the 10 capabilities that I've listed. But, okay, so what? Why does that have any moral significance? The term really human, as she uses it, is used in such a way as to suggest that the term has moral significance. So why should we attach any moral significance to it if it's just a positive description? This is, again, the is-ought gap, which the secularist assumptions that she's using do not allow her to bridge, because she's a modernist. Further, she makes the appeal to human dignity. But again, what is human dignity? Now, you can argue that the notion of human dignity emerged in the West as a result of Christianity, and the Christian belief that we are all made in the image of God. I'm certainly very sympathetic to this attempt to trace that idea, but if that attempt to trace the idea is a true one, and she, as a modern secular liberal, cannot make reference to religious doctrines, then what the hell does the phrase human dignity even mean? Does it have any meaning in a naturalistic context? If the natural world is shorn of all teleology and shorn of all of its formerly recognized or believed to normative dimension, what do these terms even mean? They don't mean anything. They're just things that someone like Nussbaum, a liberal like Nussbaum, might use to rhetorically puff up her position and to sort of fool people into thinking that she's actually making an argument. And when you get down to it, the proper way of interpreting her whole argument for the capabilities approach seems to me to be that she's not actually making an argument at all. She's just stating her opinions. That's really it. She's not able to make arguments for her capabilities approach, not real fundamental arguments that dive into the depths of metaphysics, because if she did that, she would have to make metaphysical commitments of a certain kind. But the strictures of secular liberal quote-unquote rationalism prevent her from doing this. And so she doesn't provide any foundations for her ethical theory. She just pretends to. And her ethics is just sort of floating in the air with no real support. And again, what we come to is that she's not really offering any real arguments for her position. She's just stating her opinions. And this makes the whole thing extremely vapid, extremely insipid and unsatisfying, and again, kind of boring. And you know, it's really quite a terrible thing when you think about it, because what an absurd demand it is to say that when talking about things of public concern, of political concern, public issues like abortion, gay marriage, how to deal with poverty, economic equality and whether it should be pursued, anything of political interest. What war, when war is just, and whom we should declare war on and why, all of these issues. If you stipulate that you're not allowed to make reference to any kind of basic metaphysical views, you can't really justify any ethical position, because any ethical position that you take, or any meta-ethical position that you take, is going to have metaphysical consequences. All of these things, no matter what your position is, are going to have fundamental metaphysical implications. There's just no way to avoid that. For example, if you're a moral realist, that's going to affect your beliefs about ontology. If you're a moral anti-realist, that's also going to affect your beliefs about ontology. So you can't come to any belief about ethics whatsoever without also, by implication, having some kind of metaphysical beliefs to undergird it. And we have to get into arguments about that. The secular liberal stipulation that we can't do this is therefore ridiculous. It just truncates discourse and makes it boring. And it makes it impossible to have a real conversation. As I said, this is the nihilism of liberalism. Liberalism says that you cannot believe in anything strongly enough to actually take it seriously. You're not allowed to take any kind of basic belief seriously anymore. How absurd, how nihilistic, how horrible, and how productive of degeneracy and decline. That's really it. That's really all I wanted to discuss. Now, there are other things, just very briefly, that Smith discusses in his book. I haven't discussed all of them. For example, he's got a very interesting chapter on the separation of church and state. And he points out that there are actually two concepts of church-state separation. The one which he calls the pre-modern concept is one that frames the matter in terms of jurisdictions. That is, the church has a legitimate legal jurisdiction which the state may not infringe on, and the state has its own legitimate legal jurisdiction which the church may not infringe on. The church and state therefore comprise two separate legal jurisdictions. And in the Middle Ages, this was taken so seriously that if there was a criminal on the run from the law and he took refuge in a church, the state authorities were actually not allowed to arrest the criminal until he physically exited the church, because to arrest a criminal while he was inside a church would be to trespass on the church's jurisdiction. The other conception of church-state separation, the more modern one, is based on a notion of neutrality. That is, the state must take an attitude of neutrality to all religious institutions and really all institutions whatsoever, all parts of civil society. He has to treat them on an equal playing field neutrally. That's what the state must do. Now, this leads to many kind of thorny problems. For example, if the state were to decide to tax churches, many people would object to this policy on the grounds that it violates the separation of church and state. But they're presupposing the pre-modern concept of church-state separation here. The concept of church-state separation that relates to two separate legal jurisdictions, one for the state and one for the church. Now, if you're committed to the modern conception, though, one that says that the state has to treat all institutions and civil society neutrally, then there is no justification for why the state can't tax the church. In fact, the state must tax the church, because the state taxes all other institutions. And so by not taxing the church, the state is, in a sense, privileging the church, and therefore not really being neutral with respect to it, and that could be said to violate church-state separation. And the problem with a lot of arguments about separation of church and state is that this modern and pre-modern conception, the modern and pre-modern conceptions are often conflated, and the result is this really bad, muddled, terrible legal reasoning. Another chapter relates to what he calls the harm principle in liberalism. Very briefly, this is a sort of more vague version of the non-aggression principle. So the harm principle was first explained and enunciated by John Stuart Mill in his essay on liberty, and just a brief digression on Mill. I think Mill is the most overrated figure in the entire history of political philosophy. Never has a man had a greater reputation for intellectual achievement and deserved it less. He dithered all the time. He was terribly inconsistent. His mind was extremely muddled. I should make a video at some point about Mill in the future. By the way, also, just kind of as a random thing, there's a wonderful book about Mill and his thoughts on religion and Christianity specifically. The book is this, John Stuart Mill and the Religion of Humanity by Linda C. Rader. The book explains how Mill was influenced by his father, James Mill, to really hate Christianity and to think of it as not only untrue but immoral, and how that inspired him to take up the program of creating what he called the Religion of Humanity. This is sort of very similar to Auguste Comte's notion of the Religion of Humanity, and how he worked for that. And if you really examine what's meant by this Religion of Humanity thing, you find something very akin to what sort of basic liberals believe. Very much like what the vapid liberal woman that I mentioned in the Facebook thread that I read through believed. This kind of universal tolerance, sort of universalism, nations don't matter, races don't matter, religious particularities don't matter. None of that matters. We're all human. We all should just, you know, be tolerant of each other and so on. That sort of thing. It's also at the center of the moral beliefs that a lot of new atheists accept. You see this most strongly probably in Christopher Hitchens and Sam Harris. I won't go too deeply into them. I'll just say that Sam Harris is another example of just someone using just terrible moral reasoning. His whole book, The Moral Landscape, just starts off with the fundamental premise that what is moral is that which promotes the well-being of conscious creatures, but of course none of the terms in that statement are properly defined, and so the argument just collapses into nonsense almost immediately. Now, that's just one of the problems with it. Now, so as I said, to go back to the main thread of the discussion, Smith has a chapter in his book on the harm principle, and Mill came up with it, and his statement of it in his essay on liberty, published in 1859, was that the only justification that the state, or that any individual living in society, has to coercively restrict the liberty of another individual is if that at first is if that individual to be restricted is using his liberty to harm someone else, some other individual or group of individuals. Now, this seems very obvious. If a person is doing something that harms no one, why prevent him from doing it? It's intuitively appealing, intuitively obvious, and I would venture to say that almost no one would disagree with it. Now, the basic point that Smith makes about the harm principle so expressed is that it has no content. It doesn't mean anything. How is the term harm defined, for example? Is it defined purely subjectively, so that whatever one says is harm, whatever one says harms one, really does harm one? Well, let's say that I live in a neighborhood of puritanical people, and I want to drink alcohol in the privacy of my own home, or, you know, watch X-rated videos or something like that. He actually uses that example in the book. And the people in my neighborhood learn of this, and they're very bothered by this. This moral reprobate, this degenerate lives among them, and they fear that because of my degenerate behavior, I may undermine the social fabric and weaken the moral standards of the society that they have. And so they can say that that harms them. Is that therefore a justification for them to restrict my ability to drink alcohol in the privacy of my own home or watch porn? Now, a liberal would say no. But why would he say no? Well, it's because he's defining harm in a special way. So what that means is that you can't actually define harm in the totally subjective way, which has it that whatever someone says is harm, because that will justify all sorts of restrictions on liberty that that liberals will find unacceptable. So then they have to resort to making specific technical definitions of what harm is. Now, that's not such a bad thing, but one must realize that as soon as one makes these technical, non-intuitive definitions of harm, the harm principle immediately loses much of its intuitive appeal. Okay? So, when Mill goes on to try and define precisely what he means by harm, and not only Mill, but another liberal theorist that he discusses, Joel Feinberg, who's written a tetralogy, four books, on harm and the harm principle. try and explain it, you know, very precisely and very clearly. What Mill and Feinberg both essentially wind up saying in the end is that if individual A harms individual B, it means that individual A has done something to prevent individual B from achieving one of his interests. But not just any interest, a legitimate interest. And how do we distinguish legitimate from illegitimate interests? Well, it depends on what rights people have, things that they have a right to. So if you prevent someone from doing something that he has a right to do, then you have harmed him in the special technical sense of harm advocated by Mill and Feinberg. But of course, this raises the question, what is a right? Now, you would think that someone like Mill and Feinberg, if they were serious about providing ultimate philosophical justifications for their views, would create an elaborate theory of rights to try and explain these sorts of things precisely. They don't do this. In fact, Feinberg explicitly rejects this approach because, again, he's confined by that cage of secular liberalism that says that we can't make fundamental metaphysical assumptions because these are controversial. And so he doesn't do it, and he again winds up producing an argument that is quite bad and that is not likely to convince anyone who does not already accept it. Now, I would like very briefly to distinguish Feinberg's approach to his approach to liberalism with the harm principle from libertarians and the non-aggression principle. Now, libertarians also have a technical definition of what they count as aggression. And aggression would be a violation of an individual's legitimate property rights. So that means that what counts as aggression depends on what people's property rights are. And so the truly fundamental basis of libertarianism is a theory of property rights. And that theory of property rights may derive from a natural rights approach like the one Rothbard takes, or the argumentation ethics approach that someone like Hans-Hermann Hoppe takes in you know, either of these two works here, Economics and Ethics of Private Property and Theory of Socialism and Capitalism. So when people say that the non-aggression principle is the fundamental basis of libertarian philosophy, they're wrong. No, it isn't. The real fundamental basis of libertarian philosophy is a theory of property rights, because what counts as aggression depends on what people's property rights are. So the most basic thing first is to establish property rights. So, like, for example, Hoppe, through argumentation ethics, tries to establish self-ownership, and then he says that survival is a good thing. And so if one is to remain alive, if one is to prolong one's existence, one must acquire property in addition to simply one's own body. And from that, he goes on to argue for principles of the legitimate appropriation and transfer of property. So first use, voluntary exchange, and so on. I won't go into detail on these things because I don't want to make this a video about libertarianism. But the point is that the philosophically sophisticated libertarians like Hoppe know that what's really at the bottom of libertarianism, the real bedrock of it, is not the non-aggression principle, it's property rights. That's what libertarianism is really about, property rights. The non-aggression principle is just a corollary of the libertarian view of property. Now, another interesting thought is that in addition to his sort of argumentation ethics approach that he takes, where he says that when one sits down to engage in argument, the norms of argument presuppose a respect for the physical body of the other person and an agreement not to attack the other person. That is, when you're making arguments and when you're trying to debate another person and trying to convince them of your position or to argue for your position, you don't say, accept my position or I'll break your legs. Because at that point, you're not arguing. You're not having a debate anymore. You're threatening the person. And so, implicitly, in argument, one presupposes a respect for the principle of self-ownership, that is, the self-ownership of the person with whom you're arguing. Because if you don't presuppose that, you're no longer having an argument. So what Hoppe then says is that it would be a performative contradiction to argue against self-ownership, because by engaging in argument itself, you've already presupposed it. And then from that, he throws in the assumption that survival is a good thing, and that allows him to derive homesteading and the rest of libertarian property theory. Now, there's a very interesting article that was brought to my attention by Stefan Kinsella. The article's called Hopping Onto New Ground. Sorry for the bad pun. Wasn't my idea, but that's the name of the title. That's the name of the article. And I'll include a link to the article in the description. What this article attempts to do is to integrate Hoppe's argumentation ethics approach into the larger scholastic natural law tradition. Because what Hoppe actually does is that in addition to his statements about argument and the norms presupposed there, he also says that survival is a good thing, and he also assumes a kind of universalizability principle. That is, that ethical precepts must be universalized. They must apply universally in all relevantly similar situations. He doesn't really justify these kinds of assumptions, but I think the reason for that is that he takes them as so basic as to not really be open to question. When it comes to the survival assumption, you could say, well, if you own yourself and you don't presuppose that you can appropriate and come to own other property, then you will soon, die anyway, and you've kind of, thrown away your own ownership. And so if you don't presuppose the ability of someone to legitimately appropriate property and use it to prolong their lives, we'd all die if you were to universalize that norm. That's true, but someone does not need resources of all kinds at every moment. I mean, not even air. You could hold your breath and not breathe and suffocate and kill yourself that way, but you'd still survive for some amount of time. So that wouldn't result in instant death. So I contend that he's making assumptions about the inherent goodness of survival and that universalizability principle, and that he's adding it to his argumentation ethics. Now, the way to deal with this is to realize that argumentation ethics should really be incorporated and integrated into a broader metaphysical system, the natural law system. That old pre-modern ethical system which saw nature as being inherently teleological, and that's what this article tries to argue for. So Hoppe is in that sense a pre-modern philosopher. He's completely gone against the grain of modern thought and produced a kind of libertarianism which is based in property rights and in which those property rights are based in the natural law. And that distinguishes him completely from all modern liberals, in that he's not afraid to go into this kind of deep metaphysics, whereas the cage, as Smith calls it, of liberal modernity prevents one from doing that. So that's sort of all I wanted to say. Just make the point at the end that, again, to be a liberal means that you can't take anything seriously. You have to be a nihilist because you are so committed to peace at any price that you're not allowed to argue about anything fundamental because, heaven forfend, it might provoke a disagreement. Another interesting thing, though, is the kind of pessimism about the power of reason here. No one entertains the thought that it's possible to, by reason, determine what true beliefs about religion are, for example. The assumption among liberals is that reason can't resolve these conflicts, and so it has to bracket them aside. But the point is that if you bracket all of these fundamental worldviews aside, you don't have anything left anymore on which to base a society. Liberalism, therefore, is nihilistic. It is the void. It is nothing. It is an attempt to take the fundamental worldviews offered by religion, like, say, Catholicism, and to replace them with the void, to replace them with nothing. Because, to say it one final time, to be a liberal means that you're not allowed to believe in anything strongly enough to actually take it seriously. That produces vapid discussion. And for someone like me, who cares about these sort of intellectual matters, that really goes a long way to explaining why we live in this horribly decadent age in which intellectualism just continues on the decline and we have all of this nonsense. So that's that. That's all I wanted to say. Thank you for listening.